sorry about spoilers. Okay. Okay, so thank you for that. And now we are going into the spoiler section. And for realsies, if you happen to see this video without seeing it, please, to retain the full impact of the film, go and see it before you watch the spoilers section. So end right there. And then, if you've already seen it, if you're one of the elites, because you knew you were going to see it on day one, you wanted to see it on Thursday, you wanted to see it on Friday, welcome to the spoiler section. And welcome back if you're watching the video after, you know, a few days or weeks, and we can talk now. Go ahead.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to say. I want to make sure it's like, look, we joke, and we're like, spoilers now, but like, the cameos and some of the twists and turns in this movie really provide a ton of the impact, and I can absolutely see a bunch of people going, it was okay, yet everything is spoiled for them. So I think it is really...
Yeah, that is definitely a part of its charm, is being like, oh, fuck. Spoilers. You can be like, oh, you know, we are all expecting Captain America, and then I don't feel like that would have the same impact on me if I knew beforehand.
Chris Evans is in this film, and at some point, Wolverine and Deadpool get sent to the Shadow Realm, whatever the fuck they call it, with the Void, with the Shadow, Purple Shadow creature, CGI monster, that kills everything. And they end up meeting a group of characters, the variants, that are hiding out here. And the fact of the variants can let them play with whatever they want to play with. We've seen a little bit of this in the Loki television series. They go full on here. We are movie budget. We are movie prestige. So people that would normally say no to a TV show would say yes to a movie. So one of those people is Chris Evans. Initially, he is in a hood, he's dirty, but you can tell there's blue, there's red, and there's white, and you're like, whoa. And the big man, calling him the big man. But then he ends up surprising everybody, and when it's like, say the thing, and Deadpool thinks he's going to say Avengers Assemble, or whatever, and he ends up saying, flame on!
Flame on!
And it's hilarious. Evans did in fact play Johnny Storm. So it was just great, and man, it's so funny. Chris Evans does a great performance, tries to emulate his terrible accent that he was using before, and his mannerisms and the way he talks. And Deadpool really sells him out to the main villain of the film, which she, like, gets so pissed because he's talking all this shit, and Deadpool said he was talking all this shit, so she fucking rips his skin off and comes into a pile of bones. And it's a running joke throughout the film that, you know, and Wolverine's like, what, you know, so, you know, pointing it out. But if you stay, we won't say right away, we'll just say for the end, but there's an after credit scene that you have to wait for the entire credit. So there's a mid-credit scene, and the mid-credit scene is amazing. It is clips of pretty much every Fox, even Disney, even, you know, behind the scenes footage.
Yeah.
Seeing how young Hugh Jackman was when he was playing Wolverine. Seeing that Ryan Reynolds did in fact play Deadpool before he played Deadpool. And he'd always want to. And this takes me back all those years, 10, 20 years ago, when all this was starting. And I was like, man, that's our guy. Hopefully we get in. And we saw what that original Deadpool was, which was hilarious. And they've made jokes on that before. And stuff. But this one is kind of a love letter to it. And, so that was the first big one. What other ones we got?
You want to go list all the cameos?
Yeah.
Blade, like Wesley Snipes showing his blade was just so incredible.
First off, there's a resistance group that is a separate part. You have essentially Charles Xavier's twin. I don't know nothing about no Cassandra Nova or whatever her name is. And actually, she said it so fast. So a person who isn't a comic book person, a person who doesn't know all the deep lore of this kind of stuff, would probably be lost. I would imagine if you haven't been watching comic book movies for 20 years, and I probably should have said this in the review, I'd imagine you could be 8, you know, 8, 9. I don't really see 6 or 7. That's not, I don't see that. see 8 or 9 or something like that. And maybe 7 if you, like, not into comic book movies at all. So I don't know much about her. And she, what does she say? What was the thing about that biblical war?
She tried to kill him.
Okay, because I thought she was saying that Xavier tried to kill her. And that's why she's all bad.
Yeah, that's why she turned evil.
But in this variant, in her world, maybe she killed Xavier.
Well, she was transported there as an infant. So she's been in the void since she was a baby. So.
Right, so they knew right away that it's like, we gotta take this ultra-powerful evil bitch and put her in the void. Okay, and she had killed Charles Xavier as a baby in the womb before anything could even happen. I kept thinking, wait, we might get a Patrick Stewart, you know, cameo, who shows up and puts her in her place. But that man's tired of fucking playing Xavier.
Yeah, he did a cameo in his next name.
Yeah, so that didn't work out too well.
Yeah, the Indian credit was
awesome.
Alright,
and her powers are really fucking cool. Did she, like, in order to read your mind, she puts her face, she's like, I like to get dirty. And then put it in there, and like, it comes through people's faces, and I think it's hilarious when she's doing it to Mr. Paradox, who is this TVA engine, which kind of serves as a sub-villain, or another villain. But she's just, like, moving his body, like, a little rag. That was, like, brutal and interesting, and for somebody without superpowers and without immediate regen powers, he'd be dead. But we won't talk about that, but it's Paradox has his own personal scenario, so I think they're friendly, but not real. That would have been better. So you got that, and then, so, of the separate faction, eventually, Deadpool and Wolverine run into Dogpool, and it's an ugly Dogpool, and they have a moment, and people who love ugly dogs are gonna love this moment, and to me, I'm like, that dog is just too ugly for me. I'm not into it, but I get it. Turns out that this ugly pool dog is owned by Handsome Pool. This is a Ryan Reynolds without a mask. It's a perfect face. And he's just a nice guy.
He's Canadian. He does the sword. Yeah,
sorry, he's got the golden guns. Deadpool's like, gonna have those right away. And then now with my dead body. So you know it's gonna happen at some point. But eventually, they take the help of them out. Apparently, there's lots of Deadpools, they say, in this, because Deadpool is just one of those aberrations that always ends up in the void. And, but he helps them and gives them a fucking, what kind of car?
Honestly, really, man.
An ongoing joke, a lot of the jokes hit in this, and I really enjoyed it. More often than not, I think I was like, not laughing 80-90% of the time. Doing that, it's just such an entertaining ride. So eventually they get into a fight, and so this is a buddy film, constantly talking shit. Eventually, fucking Hugh Tech gets fucking sick of it. Let's fucking go. We got a great fucking. You know who's actually fighting in the car now? I guess Russian channels. So they're fighting in the fucking car, but eventually they get knocked out and they get taken to. Resistance, and this is where we get on cameo. So, first cameo, Elektra. Like, I did not expect Elektra, and I was like, such a cheesy, tongue-in-cheek thing, but man, she's playing it like, hey, man, I was a badass back in my day, and I'm like, all right, good.
I watched the Netflix series, but they play with everything, too, because even they mentioned Daredevil dying, and she's like, yeah, that was dumb. Everything is a joke in this, and so as long as you someone is not clapping next to you, goddamn seal.
Yeah, our relationship with that aspect.
Yeah, it's like it's so like there's a lot of times, especially when the next cameos that comes up, fucking change.
Yeah, it comes to this was amazing.
Thank you.
If you want to send some stuff to me so I can check out what you have sent, please send it to this exact address. However, you may only send some stuff that I am interested in. No airplane, okay? Because if you send something like this, I will make sure that I will tell you that I do not like this film at all. So make sure you send stuff like this, or this, or this, or this. And yes, even Airplane 2, the sequel.
Oh, and get this, a special collector's edition of Twister, complete with a steelbook that features not only the secondary poster artwork, but the image of the pipe scene on the back. Heck yeah, I'm getting this.
And also Airplane 2, the sequel, which had this cover.
Just look at those nuts. I can't keep up with them all. And even the one in the original theatrical poster. Like, look at it.
And just look at this poster for the worst film of all time.
I mean, come on, do they really need to tie that plane up into a nun?
I mean, that part never actually happened in the film. I mean, they clearly just used a toy model plane. Like, come on, really? And yes, this is what the plane actually looks like in the film. And here's another image of that same goddamn plane model, also from the film. God damn it, I hate this film.
And it's different titles, like this one known as Flying High, but I would refer to the film with this title.
I just hated it so much. So make sure you send in to this address and I hope to God I will look at them. And in the words of the good old immortal named Connor McLeod,
there can be only one.